Jeanne Murphy was born in Macaé, Rio de Janeiro, to a Spiritist family. From her childhood, Jeanne was involved with the Spirit's precepts in her home as well as in the Spirit centers which she attended from a very early age. Jeanne received her education in Brazil, USA, France, and Canada. She has been living in Canada for 17 years and has worked for the Peel District School Board as a teacher for the last 15 years. She is a mother of three children and presently lives in Mississauga, where she attends the Mississauga Christian Spirit Center. It is with very happy and with a great honor that I introduce you to all to Jeanne.
It is really a pleasure to be here. I'm quite happy to have come back. This, I guess, happened a couple of years ago, and the fact that they invited me back made me feel good. Anyway, I hope everybody's nourished. Ready to sit for another little while. If you get tired, or if I notice you get tired, I will stop and maybe we'll do a little bit of brain gym for like 2 minutes, and then we'll sit down again. So I'll just kind of monitor as things go, as things happen. Anyway, one thing that I neglected to let them know about my was that I think I am the first Spiritist woman to convert an Irish Catholic to Spiritism. I'm really happy. Married an Irish man. There I come from a small little town, Macaé. You know, no one knows about Macaé. Maybe now because of the petroleum and oil there, but no one knew in those days. And when I meet this guy in the States, and you know, we're teenagers. And I remember he was born and raised in Ireland from a very Catholic family. And when the subject of spirituality and religion came up, and I told him that I was a Spiritist, he was like, oh, so what, you know, I'm dating this girl, I don't really mind, whatever. He goes back to Ireland, and he's talking to his mother, who is very Catholic, extremely religious, goes to Mass every day, and she says, you met this new girl in the States, and what is she like? And first he just, what's her religion? Something like Spiritism, I don't know. And she goes, isn't that the religion that they like talk to the spirits? Oh no, you don't know what you're talking about. And so he, you know, talked to me on the phone. So my mom thinks you guys talk to the spirits. And I said, well, we kind of do. Well, the eyes rolled and it's like, oh my gosh, what are we getting into? And today, actually, he's a very active working medium in our center. Believe it or not. So that was my great deed for this lifetime. So anyway, let's turn this on. When Josada called me and said, she asked me if I could do a presentation here. What's this thing here now? It's just going up. Oh, there it is. But very lights off. So when she asked me to do this presentation, she said the theme was life goes on. And I thought, wow, very appropriate to any time in our lives, something that we deal with on a daily basis is the fact that we are mortals. Our mortality is part of who we are. It's the only certainty we have when we're born. We don't know what's going to happen, what our lives are going to, which avenues we're going to take in life. But one certainty we have from the moment we're born is basically that sooner or later we will die. And yet we seem to live in a society that kind of denies that. We try not to think about it very much. When it happens, like when I'm 95, I'll deal with it then. But until then, you know, it's not gonna happen. unfortunately, that's not the reality. And we all know that very well. I'm sure every single person in this room has been touched by death, one way or another. A loved one who passed away, a friend, or a loved one of, related to a friend. I actually know someone right now who's going through a very difficult time. His husband died very suddenly. And is having, her life is miserable right now. And nothing like the Spiritist doctor to give us that strength that we need to deal with death. So my presentation then is about exactly that. How do we come to accept, to understand death, to accept and to prepare for it? And I try to put in into this presentation the scope of communication with spirits, that being the major scope of this whole weekend, from my understanding. So anyway, I just wanted to tell you a little quick story about this man who lived in a small village, and as he's walking home one day in a rural area, he gets the sense that he's being followed. It's dark, it's nighttime, so as he's walking home, and you know, when you get that sense, that sixth sense, someone is behind you or something's happening, and you're almost too afraid to look, and you start walking faster, and you just want to get home, and you pray to your guardian angel, watch over me, whatever, I don't know who's behind me. So he gets very frightened, and he's going very fast. And all of a sudden, he passes by this beam of light. So as he goes by the beam of light, and he says, I can look quickly back now and see who it is that's following me. And as he passes and he's the light and he looks back and he realizes it was just an old donkey that used to kind of roam around the village. And he goes, oh, it's okay. He relaxes and continues on his journey home. And that's exactly what Spiritism is. Spiritism is that beam of light that sheds light and sets the all mysterious path of return, chasing away irrational fears and disturbing feelings. When we have these fears of death, we have irrational ideas about death, and Spiritism sheds light on it and makes us realize really, it's not all about what, there is no reason for us to fear death. It's a part of life. We all know we're going to go through it. So, we should all be thankful, those of us who are here who follow the precepts of the Spiritist doctrine, very thankful for having been introduced to the Spiritist, to this wonderful doctrine that gives us so much to hold on to. Anyway, when I first thought that I would be doing this presentation, I thought, okay, I need to get some information. I had some books at home, Spiritist books, but I wanted to also kind of expand my scope and go outside of the Spiritist doctrine, see what I could find in terms of death, what's out there. And there's a lot out there, much more than I could possibly delve into. So I go to the public library. I had done a little bit of research online, and I go out with a pile of books, you know, Social History of Death, and Dr. Elizabeth Ross, and Dr. Raymond Moody, and a pile of books. And I think the lady that was checking out the books was thinking, oh, this is a spooky lady here. She's having 20 books on death. Very morbid. She must be, you know, doing some kind of a cult or something. I get home, and my 10-year-old girl looks at it and she says, what is it with you and death? Oh my gosh. So I spent my summer reading all these books on death. In many ways enlightening, in some other ways like actually funny, some of the things I read. And then in my readings, in my research, I came across some information that I thought was very interesting that I would like to share with you. And some of it most of it actually supports very much our Spiritist thoughts. And it's backed up by, and it's all put together by a scientist. And I thought, whoa, this is great, this is amazing. And I had never heard of this guy until then. And maybe you have or you haven't. But I think it's a journey worth taking. So we'll start with what is death. And if you look in the dictionary, okay, this is what you get, right? We all know that. Your vital functions cease to happen, right? In your organism, everything shuts down, right? So then you have death. So it's a biological phenomenon. It's the natural ending of our physical journey and the start of a new state of molecular transformation. Now, this would be what you see in the dictionary, and this is what you see in the Spiritist book for a definition of death, because all of a sudden it's telling us that we're just going from one state to another, going from one plane. There you go. Thank you so much. One plane to the next. You just transform. You just change, right? And it continues. Because in Spiritism, we know that there is a difference between actually dying, the molecular, physical act of death, when your system shuts down, and the act of disintegrating. Because you might actually be still connected with your physical body. So your perispirit, or your, if you want to call your energy body, is still connected. So it's not until that disconnect happens that you actually have disincarnated. So we quite often use that word in Portuguese to say, oh, he disincarnated, but in some cases he may or may not have yet, depending how soon we're talking. So disincarnating happens after the organic death process, and it takes individual parameters different in time and circumstance from person to person. A person, let's say, who has committed suicide may not have disconnected or may not disconnect as fast as someone who led a totally different kind of life, who, let's say, led a life where death happened naturally. And it all depends too, if you had a certain death, if you had a death caused by an accident, if you had a death after a long illness. This will all influence as to how long it takes for the actual disconnect, for what we call that silver cord, to be disconnected between your physical body and your spiritual body. So that would be the idea of death within the Spiritist framework. Okay, so there is the organic death, and then there is the actual rupture of that cord that actually sets you free in your spiritual life. So, the whole point of this presentation was life goes on. So, is there life after death? For all of us who are Spiritists, we just say, sure. Like second nature, I don't have to think about this. Yes, but for many other people, it doesn't seem as natural. It doesn't seem like it's not a quick yes answer. They have to think, I don't know, maybe depending on whatever background they have, religious background, they may have some ideas which they may be even questioning, depending on the nature of their beliefs and how they were nurtured as they were growing up in religious